Well, I want to welcome you to our Resurrection Sunday service. We are so glad that you're able to tune in with us today. If you're visiting with us, we really appreciate that, and we welcome you, and we're praying that God will bless you. I've been starting these services with a song, and my hope is that it's a familiar song to you, and you're able to sing along, but mostly I'm hoping that it encourages you and that these songs will prepare your heart for worship. People who have in the past told me that they can worship on the couch of their living room. I don't know if they're telling me the full truth because, beloved, I'm really missing our congregational singing. Many a week I have, in the years I've been in church, I've been able to sing a song all through the week, and it's always one that we had in our worship service. It just keeps resonating in my heart, and I'm able to sing them unto the Lord. So I want us to begin today with a song, and this is a song about Easter. One of the things about Easter is that there is a miraculous change in the attitude of the people. And I want you to hear that in this song. Here it is. Then came the morning.
They all walked away, nothing to say. Just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, hammer, the nail, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turned into day, the stone was them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again.
Death had lost, and life
Well, that song really blesses me. And Easter is a time where nature's seasons remind us of the seasons of life. I mean, there is spring where new growth is popping up out of the earth, and then there's summer and later fall, and then there's winter when all the living things lie dormant. The first Easter weekend, some 2,000 years ago, it felt like winter. And then spring, all in the same weekend. Kind of like our weather that we've had here lately. Last Sunday, I was looking for shade when I was preaching in our drive-in church. It was so warm. And then on Good Friday, I was trying to find the sun because it was absolutely freezing on the front steps of our church. Well, for those who knew Jesus in the first century, on Good Friday, all hope was shattered as Jesus, who they knew would be the Messiah, was executed as a common criminal. And it was like living in a bleak winter all over again. Nothing happened that long Passover Saturday as every good Jew stayed indoors for the Sabbath. Likely, the believers were mourning the terrible events of the day before. But on Sunday, spring bursts forth, and everything just seems to be singing out, "He is risen." The empty tomb brought a whole new perspective. Consider then with me the empty tomb and what it means to us even to this day. We're in Luke chapter 24, and I begin reading at the first verse. It says, "Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and then the third day rise again? And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre and told all these things unto the 11 disciples, and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna, and Mary the mother of James, and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. Then arose Peter and ran unto the sepulchre, and he, stooping down, beheld the linen cloth laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at that which was come to pass." So, beloved, in this wonderful Easter story, what we find is that despair turns to hope. The first thing that Easter brings is hope. You know, I love that song that we heard this morning. It was a morning like this? It really tells the story of that first resurrection morning. For days, the disciples and Mary, the mother of Jesus, were in mourning, brokenhearted, and in fear. Everything they had put their hope in was now dead. And they watched him as he died. They then went and took his lifeless body off of the cross, some of the disciples, and they wrapped it and laid it in a tomb. And then early in the morning, these women head to prepare the body of their master. And their hope is further crushed when they go in and they see that someone stole the body of their Lord. And so the Bible says two men appeared to them. And they have a message for these downhearted women. Now, these men of verse 4 were certainly angels, and they presented a shocking message to the women. In verse 5, they asked the question, "Why seek ye the living among the dead?" And then they proclaim, "He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke unto you as he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again." And if you'll notice, their hearts turned from fear to hope as they recalled the way that Jesus tried to prepare them for his death and resurrection. With the angels prodding, it all came back to them. It was as if the light finally turned on and everything made sense. Then verse 11 tells of the reception that they received from the disciples. It says, "But the disciples did not believe the women because their words seemed to them to be like nonsense, idle tales." And then in verse 12, Peter, he decided, "I'm going to check this out." He jumps up and he runs to the tomb. The disciples discount the testimony of these women, perhaps just because it was the women, but maybe it was because it just seemed so far-fetched to be true. But Peter had enough hope to go to the tomb and check it out for himself. The men and the women who went to bed in despair were met the next morning with a surprising hope. The same hope that is available to us today. Beloved, if Jesus is alive, he can bring the dawn of resurrection into your life. As long as Jesus is alive, there is hope for you. Easter gives us hope. Hope that when we're at a dead end in our life, God can bring us through. Hope that no matter how alone we are, we never have to be lonely because he is with us. And he promised, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake you." Easter brings hope. And it also brings forgiveness. Friday, we talked about what Jesus was doing on the cross. He was taking on the sin of man, of all of mankind, of all of the world, and it was placed upon him so that he could fulfill the justice of a holy God. The innocent Lamb of God became sin, and he did it willingly for you and for me. Beloved, that is love. Why did an innocent man have to die? Not because of it was because none of us are innocent. We have all sinned, the Bible says. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. And the only way a holy and perfect God could be in a relationship with us is if someone took our punishment. If someone who did not deserve it, someone who was holy, and there was only one, and his name is Jesus. Listen to what Romans 5:8 says. It says that God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died. You don't have to clean up before you can be saved. You can come just as you are because he loves you completely, just the way you are. C.S. Lewis gave a metaphor for the sacrificial death of an innocent in his classic book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And there he told the story of the great lion Aslan. He loved every child. He even loved naughty Edmund. And he ended up giving his life as a sacrifice in their place so that the curse of the white witch could be dispelled once and for all, and the dreadful winter of Narnia could turn into spring. When Jesus died on the cross, he willingly laid down his life for you, paying the price for every sin you would ever commit, so that we can say with the Apostle Paul in Romans 8:1, "There is now therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus our Lord." Once we accept Jesus as our personal Savior, God no longer condemns us. And if God doesn't condemn us, we can't condemn ourselves. We need to stop condemning ourselves. And we can find the forgiveness each of us so desperately needs. Easter gives us a fresh start, a blank slate, a do-over, a mulligan, if you will. Thank you, God, because we need that fresh start. We can't do that on our own. We need Him. Easter brings hope. And beloved, Easter brings forgiveness. And there's one other thing I want to share with you that Easter brings. Easter brings life. Notice what the angels asked the women in verse 5 again. Why do you look for the living among the dead? Indeed, why would you? Jesus was no longer dead. He was very much alive. The tomb was empty. When Jesus came back to life, He reversed the curse of all mankind. You see, the Bible calls Jesus the second Adam. The first Adam led us into despair and sin and death. The second Adam, Jesus, He leads us into hope, forgiveness, and life. That's why the Apostle Paul would later write, "Death, where is your victory? Grave, where is your sting?" If you belong to Jesus, you don't have to fear anything. What's the worst thing that could happen to you should you die? The worst thing that could happen is that you'll be in the presence of Jesus. You'll be able to go to heaven and be with Him forever. One of the best loved verses in all the Bible is probably John 3:16. You see it everywhere you go. And it reads, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Jesus brings us life, eternal life, life to the full. Jesus said, "I've come that you might have life, and that life more abundantly." Yeah, I know that means in eternity, but it means right here today. It's not the material things that He came to bring us. It's the spiritual things, freedom, joy, peace, peace with God. And that begins the moment that we believe, and it continues all into eternity. I've said this before many times in the past few weeks, but I need to say it again. It's a quote from D.L. Moody, a great evangelist. He said, "One day you will hear that D.L. Moody has died." He said, "Don't you believe it, for in that moment I will be more alive than I have ever been. I'll just have a change of address." These words are profound. It's a statement that reveals His ultimate trust in the resurrection. Beloved, do you have that same assurance? Do you know that you belong to God? If not, you can change that today. It's very simple. You merely need to say to God, you can do it in your thoughts, you can do it in your heart, you can do it out loud, and just say something like, "God, here's my life. Please forgive me of my sin, all of my sin. Come into my life, come into my heart, and I trust you, Jesus, to take me to heaven when I die." Beloved, you make that your prayer and you earnestly mean that, there's going to be a change in your life. And we would love to help you start this adventure with God, a God who loves you and forgives you and promises that He will never leave you or forsake you. Give us a call. My home phone number at the parsonage is 270-757-1139. Give me a call. Let's talk about this. Let's see that you grow in this new life that you have in Christ. Let me pray for you. God, I thank you that we have this Easter Sunday. I thank you that we have the marvelous resurrection. Thank you that it gives us life. It gives us peace. God, I thank you that it gives us hope. Right now, we are struggling in a great way for us, and I think a little way for the things of eternity. But Lord, we are struggling. We are hurting. We have people that are separated that need to be together. And we do pray for healing. But God, I pray that this resurrection morning, we would have the hope that you give. We would have the peace that passes all understanding. And God, that we would have the patience to endure all the things that we're going through. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Thank you for your resurrection. Thank you for ascending to heaven. And I thank you that you're praying for us today, everyone listening to this message. And I pray this in Jesus' name. You know, beloved, today is a reminder that Jesus, our Redeemer, lives. I want you to listen to Keisha sing this powerful message. Keisha?
The sun, where to stand in the morning, and who told the ocean you can only come this far, and who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Spins things in orbit. He runs to the weary, the worn, and the weak. And the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken. The pain.